Good afternoon. Today the topic is MCQs on generalized anxiety disorder, panic disorder and agoraphobia. Myself, Dr. Sanjeevi, assistant professor, Department of Psychiatry. So we'll start with the first MCQ. Which of the following disorders is classified under anxiety disorder under DSM-3? A. Obsessive compulsive disorders. B. Depression. C. Schizophrenia. D. Bipolar disorder. Actually, DSM is Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. It has been prepared by American Psychiatric Association. Currently, we are using DSM-5 and DSM-3 was used around, maybe 10-15 years ago. So, at that time, one of these disorders was classified under anxiety. So, which one is that? And the answer is Obsessive Compulsive Disorders. So in DSM-3, OCD was part of an anxiety disorder, but currently in DSM-5, OCD is a different classes. It belongs to different class. It's a class in itself, like obsessive compulsive related disorders. So which are the anxiety disorders in DSM-5? DSM again, I'll say it is Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders by American Psychiatric Association. And according to DSM-5, the anxiety disorders are separation anxiety disorder, selective mutism, specific phobia, panic disorder, agoraphobia, generalized anxiety disorder, and substance medication induced anxiety disorder. Now, we'll read details later, but I'll just say a brief sentence or two. Separation anxiety disorder is mostly seen in children or also in adults, in which the primary fear is being separated from people you love, and then the fear that you might not be reunited of them because of death or disease or kidnapping, something like that. Selective mutism is seen in children where the child can speak normally, but in selected situations the child won't speak, maybe at school or in front of strangers, but otherwise if the child is comfortable or with the primary caregivers, he or she will speak normally. Specific phobia is fear of a particular object. It may be natural things like insects, or it may be situations like in a closed space, or it may be fear of blood. So we'll go into detail in later classes. Panic disorder and agoraphobia has already been covered for you, and I'll go, as we do the MCQs, we'll again revise those. Same goes for generalized anxiety disorder. We'll also revise this. And substance medication induced anxiety disorder is, it is said to be substance medication induced when it follows closely after the substance medication substance is used, and then if the substance is stopped, the anxiety also stops. So that is like a confirmatory, okay, this was because of the substance. Because substance starts, anxiety starts, and substance stops, anxiety stops. So those are the substance or medication induced anxiety disorder. Again, I will say OCD previously was a part of anxiety disorder, but now it is a separate class in itself according to DSM-5. So the next question is, what is phobia? Phobia is A. Psychosis, B. Anxiety, C. Fear of mind, and D. Neurosis. So the most appropriate answer is anxiety. Actually, phobia, as we noticed in the previous slide, phobia is a classified under anxiety disorders in DSM-5, and that is the most appropriate answer. Neurosis can also be answer, because in phobia the reality testing is intact, but still, because we have anxiety as one of the options, it is a better answer compared to neurosis. So again, the same thing, that DSM-3 OCD was a different thing, and according to DSM-5, as we can see, specific phobia is a part of DSM-5 anxiety disorders. So the correct answer according to the different options here is anxiety disorder. Had there been no anxiety among the options and something else would have been there, then phobia might have also come under neurosis. But anxiety is more appropriate since it is already there. Let's see. In this question, phobia is a type of A. Psychosis, B. Neurosis, C. Mania, and D. Depression. Here you can see that there is no anxiety in the options. Either it is psychosis, neurosis, mania, or depression. So among these four choices, the most appropriate answer will be neurosis. So what is psychosis versus neurosis? At the outset, let me make this clear. Then in DSM-5, we don't use these terms like neurosis. This is an older term used in psychiatry. Currently, it has been replaced But still, from you know, from an undergraduate point of view, this is important because this is still taught in this way at the MBBS level. Basically, psychosis is defined as a major personality disorder or a major disorder which disrupts one's emotional and mental aspects of life, results in a complete alteration of the personality with a considerable impairment or loss of insight. This is important. Like, there is loss of insight. People are not aware that they have a disorder. Patients often lose their touch with reality with an absolute distortion of it, but they may not realize that they are not well. Psychotics need medications like antipsychotics, which mainly act on their behavior, thoughts, and emotions. So in psychosis, what happens is there is a loss of touch with reality and lack of insight. These two are the hallmarks of psychosis. And what do you mean by loss of touch with reality? Because patients, they do not know what is real and what is not real. Like, suppose a person is having a delusion. For him, the delusion is very much real. But in reality, in truth, truth of other persons, it is not real. You understand? For us, we can understand that it is a disorder, you know. There are symptoms, this needs treatment. But for the patient, this is very real. Like, this is as real as anything else is to us. So, the patient has loss of touch with reality. Because for the patient, even false things appear true. And loss of insight. Like, the patient does not know that this is an illness, that he or she has an illness, that he or she should take treatment. So there is a lot of, patients don't take treatment in psychotic disorders. They don't realize they are sick. Maybe after years of treatment, some insight may be achieved, but initially there is none. But in neurosis, it is not like that. Neurosis patients themselves come to the psychiatrist saying, I have some disorders. I have this, I have anxiety, I have depression. Oh no, I have obsessive thoughts, please help me, please treat me. So there is insight. They know they are illness. And they understand that whatever the symptoms they have, that is because of illness. Suppose a patient has phobia. For example, a patient has phobia of, let's say, cockroach, okay? Patient will be when he or she will see a cockroach. He will scream, he will run. But if you ask them that, do you realize that the cockroach will not be actually able to harm you. It's not that the cockroach will eat you up or anything. They say, yes, I know that. I know the cockroach will not harm me in concrete terms. But I have this fear that I cannot control. So you see, the patient has very much insight that what he or she is doing is overreaction. But that is an illness because the patient cannot control the overreaction, cannot control the fear. Okay? But the patient is aware that, okay, this is a fear, this is my illness, and I should take treatment for it or I should take counseling for it. So, the loss of, they are in touch with reality. There is no loss of touch with reality and they have insight. So, neurosis refers to a constant struggle between an individual's personality and his patterns of behavior in a stressful condition, often associated with physical and mental disturbances. They will result in a partial change in the personality along with a mild loss of insight. In neurosis, like the patient's personality per se won't change. But in psychosis, if severe psychosis is there, the patient's personality will completely change. In the sense, a patient who is doing well in studies or doing well in work, if he or she gets schizophrenia, there will be cognitive impairment, deterioration, not able to study, drop out of the college. But in neurosis, it's not like that. The life is not that much disturbed. You know, the personality is intact. Patients know that they have been affected by a certain illness, so only a small external support will help them to overcome their condition. It is easier for them to take treatment. It is easier to make, a therapeutic alliance or rapport with the patient. It is easier to make them take medicines like that. Neurotics may only require counseling, behavior therapy, and supportive measures to control the symptoms. Sometimes, like in case of phobia, only behavioral therapy or mild depression, only behavioral therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, other types of behavioral therapy like exposure and response prevention and all, only such therapies will be enough to help the disorder. No need of very high dose of medications. So we'll come to question number 4. Anxiety is neurosis, psychosis, personality disorder? None. Now, as we have already discussed, the answer here will be neurosis. Because in anxiety, personality is not very much altered. There is no loss of touch with reality and insight is present. Or very mildly impaired, we can say. Again, this is a simple table, I think, compared to the last one. Psychosis, insight is absent. Neurosis, insight is present. Psychosis, judgment and reasoning is impaired. Obviously, you might have seen or you know read about schizophrenia patients who will do activities like you know burn their own house or take off their clothes and run on the road or become very violent and agitated. So the judgment and reasoning is impaired, but in neurosis it is mostly intact. In psychosis, reality contact is lost. In neurosis, reality contact is present. In psychosis, delusions are usually present, not always, but usually present. And in neurosis, delusions are absent. Psychosis, true hallucinations are usually present. And in neurosis, true hallucinations are usually absent. Delusion and hallucinations are the hallmark of psychosis, we can say like that. Because in delusions and hallucinations, insight is almost always absent. That is why they are called psychotic features. Change in personality may be there in psychosis. Change in personality is usually absent in neurosis. And that is why anxiety, depression, OCD, all these come under neurosis. And schizophrenia and other psychotic disorders, bipolar disorders, delusional disorders, they come under psychosis. So we'll come to the next question, which is, all are features of anxiety neurosis except... I'll just give a suggestion. When you are doing attempting these MCQs, please be very careful of these words like except, are present except or not. Because sometimes we see the question in a hurry and we miss it. Like this is the, you know, the key thing that changes the question. So they are asking that all are the features of anxiety except, like which is not. Nausea, sweating, palpitation and abnormal gait. So, which is not a feature of anxiety neurosis? And the answer is abnormal gait. Gait is how we walk, okay? How a patient walks. Abnormal gait is means patient is not walking properly, okay? That is not a feature of anxiety neurosis. So, what are the features? I'm sure it was covered in last class, but I'll just, you know, revise. Symptoms of a panic attack, okay? Panic attack is it starts very suddenly. It reaches a peak within minutes and it resolves within minutes, okay? Maybe 15 minutes or half an hour, maximum 1 hour. So it is like a, you know, peak curve will be there. So what are the symptoms of a panic attack? Palpitations, tachycardia, sweating, flushing, trembling, dyspnea, chest discomfort, nausea, dizziness or fainting. Fears of an impending medical emergency or also called as fear of impending doom, sarvanash, like that. Depersonalization, okay? Feeling that I am not this body, like I am watching myself, okay? It feels like in severe panic attacks that I dissociate from my body. My body is having the panic attack and I am watching it, like I am not a part of it, like I am watching a movie. That happens in severe panic attacks. Then the next question are, all are seen in anxiety except decreased sweating, hyperventilation, cold extremities, palpitation, all of the above. So, which is not seen? Decreased sweating. Like as we discussed in the previous slide, there will be increased sweating. All the autonomic hyperactivity, sympathetic hyperactivity will be increased. Sweating, you know, and tachycardia, feeling of nervousness, extremities are going cold. Why are extremities going cold? Because all the blood supply is directed to the central organs. So, the extremities are receiving less blood supply and that is the reason they go cold. Okay? Again, it is repeated so that you can, you know, have a revision. Palpitations, tachycardia, sweating, flushing, trembling, dyspnea, chest discomfort, nausea, dizziness or fainting, fears of an impending medical emergency and depersonalization. Okay. Anxiety neurosis is manifested by A. Difficulty in breathing, B. Complete consciousness, C. Negative thinking, D. All of the above. All of the above. Now, why all of the above? Because difficulty in breathing may be there as we just discussed in panic attacks. And complete consciousness. The consciousness is very clear. Okay. In anxiety, the patient is not in an altered consciousness. He is not confused. Altered consciousness is seen in delirium and some extent in dementia, in which the patient is confused. The consciousness is not alert. Okay. But in anxiety, the patient will be very much alert. If later you ask him or her what had happened, they can say everything. Okay, they remember everything. They can say it. While they are having the attack also, they will talk to you like a normal person. But if the consciousness is altered, you might suspect delirium or even seizures. During seizures also, the patient may have symptoms that look like a panic attack, but the patient will not be aware. So that is a differentiating feature. And negative thinking. Lacking anxiety, neurosis also covers generalized anxiety disorder. So there is negative thinking, excessive worrying, preoccupation, preoccupied with thoughts, you know, like that. So anxiety neurosis is manifested by all of these above. Again, the same slide is repeated, so I will just skip. Then the next question is, panic attack is associated with disturbance in all of the following major neurotransmitters. So serotonin, norepinephrine, GABA, and all of the above. So the correct answer is all of the above. Serotonin, norepinephrine, GABA, these are neurotransmitters that are involved not only in panic attacks but in a lot of disorders like depression. And that is one of the reasons that the depression, drugs used in depression, that is antidepressants, they are the same class of drugs used in anxiety. That's like antidepressants are used in depression and also in anxiety. They work in both. So you'll ask me then, why is it this is different presentation, that is different presentation? The answer is, frankly, we do not know. How the neurotransmitters act at molecular level is something that is still very much under research. You know, psychiatry compared to other branches of medical science is at a very nascent stage. It's at a very early stage. And I think that science has not also progressed to that level that we can study, you know, at the molecular level a lot. It is slowly progressing and every day we are getting to know new things. But compared to other branches, we are still discovering new things every day. Like every day, actually every day there is a new discovery. So why and how the same neurotransmitter abnormalities is manifesting as two different disorders is something that is still actively under research. But at this level, I would like to say that serotonin, norepinephrine and GABA, these three neurotransmitters are responsible for anxiety. I'll just say the location of the brain where these neurotransmitters are majorly disturbed. So in locus ceruleus, norepinephrine is, you know, abnormally acting. Serotonin in midbrain neurons, GABA in the limbic system, and adenosine or cholecystokinin at CNS sites that are not yet identified. Now, limbic system, I'll just digress and say a few words. Limbic system is the system in the brain that is mostly associated with emotions. Okay? And one of the primary emotions is fear. So, obviously it is but obvious that when there is anxiety, there will be some abnormality in the limbic system because of which anxiety is being manifested. And GABA is the neurotransmitter responsible for that. So we'll go to question number 9. That is, acute feeling of restlessness and sense of impending doom is seen in acute paranoia, schizophrenia, acute anxiety and mania. Okay. Now, restlessness can be seen in all of this, to be honest. So what is the key word here? The key word is impending doom. That something bad is going to happen imminently, in near future, immediately something bad is going to happen. It is like a very typical feature of panic attack. I feel that everything is going to be over. I am going to die. The world is going to be over. Like I won't survive this. This is typical of panic attack. So impending doom is the key word here. It is seen in what? Acute anxiety, obviously. Next question. Differential diagnosis of panic disorder is pheochromocytoma, myocardial infarction, mitral valve prolapse, depression, all of the above. And the answer is all of the above. Pheochromocytoma is a tumor in the adrenal glands and there is, adrenal secretion is increased and the features are very much like a panic disorder. Myocardial infarction, we all know it causes chest pain, dizziness, sweating, nausea. So obviously those are symptoms of panic disorder. Mitral valve prolapse also has the symptoms of panic disorder, dizziness, breathlessness, choking sensation, constriction in chest, in throat, same symptoms. And depression, why is depression there? Because depression and panic disorder are very much, overlapping. Sometimes we see that patient with depression also has a panic disorder, okay? So sometimes we think that this is only depression, but the patient may be secondarily depressed because of panic attacks. Like if I am having repeated panic attacks, then obviously I will become depressed. Ki pata nahi mujhe next panic attack kab hoga, when it will happen, how will I manage? So you understand. So the depression is not a primary depression. It is because of the panic attacks that I am depressed. So we have to differentiate that whether it is a primary depression or whether it is a depression because only of panic attacks. In that case, treat the panic attacks, the depression disappears, right? So these are all the differential diagnoses of panic disorder. So I have a slide for this. So what are the differential diagnoses of panic disorder? Other comorbid depression disorders like depression, different or comorbid anxiety disorder, like maybe generalized anxiety disorder may be there, or it may be the anxiety may only be because of panic attacks, that I am preoccupied that I may get another panic attack and because of that I have anxiety. Because the panic disorder itself has a definition, no? That the panic attacks are repeated and the patient has apprehension about the meaning of panic attack, or he or she changes the lifestyle because of the panic attacks. Substance use. As I had said in another question, if we are using a substance here, it may be substance of abuse, okay? Like alcohol, cannabis, marijuana, opioids, like that. Suppose I am using these substances and then I am having the anxiety. The doctor will not, if I don't tell the doctor I am taking substance, the doctor will keep on treating the anxiety and I will be keep on abusing the substance. The anxiety will never go away. So, if I stop taking those substances of abuse, then the anxiety will go away in itself. It doesn't even need treatment. So, we have to ask every patient, do you abuse any substance? Any substance. It may be smoking, you know, alcohol, cannabis, marijuana, opioids, steroids, anything. Medical condition, I just explained, pheochromocytoma, MI, myocardial infarction, mitral valve prolapse, iatrogenic. Iatrogenic means some drugs, they cause anxiety. Thyroid, suppose you are some patient is on thyroid hormone, okay? Maybe there is excessive of thyroid hormone he or she is taking. There may be thyroid hormone imbalance in the body that may cause, you know, panic attacks. Or maybe some other cause, we have to find out, okay? So the next question is, a male with symptoms mimicking myocardial infarction, but with normal ECG and X-rays, the diagnosis is... So the key word here is ECG and X-ray are normal. Sometimes in emergency, in trauma casualty, when you will be posted there in future, you will see many patients come with mujhe bahut ghabrat ho rahi hai, mere sine mein bahut dard ho raha hai. So they are in panic and the first thing that comes to your mind is the patient is having a heart attack, myocardial infarction, in layman's language, heart attack. And it is not wrong. You must rule it out. You cannot say, okay, it is nothing. It is just a panic attack. You cannot say that because what if it is really MI? How do you know? So you do an ECG. And if the ECG is normal, you do an X-ray, okay? To rule out any, you know, cardiac abnormalities, cardiac sizes increased or anything like that. So the X-ray is normal. The ECG is normal. Then you make the patient relax. Also, you take the SpO2. SpO2 is partial oxygen saturation with pulse oximeter. I don't have it, but it's a small instrument. You put it to the fingers and it shows how much oxygen saturation is there. Okay? And if all this is normal, then you can assure the patient, no, you are not having a heart attack. You can relax. You take some clonazepam or alprazolam or some other benzodiazepine and you relax. It is just a panic attack. So, if you know the ECG and X-ray is normal, that rules out other cardiac causes or other medical conditions and we can be more sure that okay, this is a panic attack. So the answer is obviously panic attack. Now we come to the next question. What is the drug of choice for panic attack? We just discussed, okay, I'll just repeat, nitrazepam, imipramine, orally disintegrating clonazepam and clonidine. So which is this? Which is it? Orally disintegrating clonazepam. Now you will tell me, ma'am, why not nitrazepam? It is also benzodiazepine. Okay, it is. But the thing with nitrazepam is, it does not have its effect immediately. Remember, panic attack is an acute illness. It will start suddenly, it will reach peak within minutes and it will resolve within 15 minutes, half an hour, maybe maximum 1 hour. Okay. So if I give them a drug, nitrazepam, which will have the onset of action after half an hour, then what is the use? By then, as it is also, panic attack is going to resolve. So, I must give her something, some drug that will immediately resolve it. Then you say, if it will resolve on its own, what is the use of giving any drug? Don't give anything, it will resolve. But the amount of anxiety, panic, impending doom, restlessness, discomfort that the patient has, you cannot tell him or her, okay, wait for 10-15 minutes. It is very difficult, okay? That's why you are giving treatment. And diltiazepam won't work because it will not have an immediate action. Imipramine is a tricyclic antidepressant that is given for preventing panic attacks, okay? But it is not the drug of choice for acute panic attack. Okay, if you give imipramine daily, a patient takes it daily, then he or she may not develop panic attack. But if already panic attack has started, then what are you going to give? Orally disintegrating clonazepam is the correct answer. Why orally disintegrating? Because we put it under the tongue, okay, submucosal, under the tongue, and it goes directly into the blood, bypassing the first phase of metabolism in the liver, okay? So, the amount that reaches the patient is more and faster. You take it, you swallow it, goes to the stomach, to the intestine, it is absorbed there, it goes to the blood, blood takes it to the liver, there is some metabolism there, then it goes and works on the brain. You know, it takes a lot of time. So, if you put it under the mucus, it will bypass that liver phase and go directly to the neurotransmitter level. And so, immediately there will be resolution of the panic attack. So, orally disintegrating clonazepam is a drug of choice for panic attack. Remember, the question here is drug of choice. Although diltiazepam, imipramine are appropriate answers, but most appropriate is orally disintegrating clonazepam. Clonidine, what is clonidine? Clonidine is mostly an antihypertensive. Okay, it is used in hypertensive crisis and also it is a calcium channel blocker. Okay, also it is used in ADHD, but ADHD is we'll cover in later chapters. So the high potency benzodiazepines alprazolam available as immediate release or extended release tablets. Immediate release tablets will help in acute attack, of course, and clonazepam available as tablets and orally disintegrating wafers are the only benzodiazepines that are indicated for the treatment of panic attack because they will have immediate onset of action. Okay, others will take time. So, the next question that we come to is agoraphobia. What is agoraphobia? Agoraphobia is A, getting caught in places where escape would be difficult. B, fear of height. C, fear of animals. Or D, fear of closed places. So, which is this? The answer is A, getting caught in places where escape would be difficult, okay? Fear of height, fear of animals, fear of closed places, those are specific phobia. Agoraphobia is getting caught in place where escape would be difficult. It may be anywhere. It may be the patient may feel that I cannot stand in a line or I cannot go outside or I cannot be alone. Because they think that in these places, if I go alone, if I have in a crowd, I may suddenly get a panic attack and then what will I do? I cannot escape. So, they always take somebody with them, you know. Even if they are traveling in by bus or train, they cannot travel alone. They will take somebody with them that they have to have a companion. Otherwise, their main fear is if I get a panic attack, I will not be able to escape. So, how will I survive like that? So, I'll just say what are the DSM-5 criteria for agoraphobia. Again, I'll repeat, DSM is Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders by American Psychiatric Association. Okay. So, the criteria A is, DSM has criteria like this. Okay, if these are fulfilled, then only we diagnose the disorder. So, A criteria is, marked fear or anxiety about two or more of the following five situations. So, what are the five situations? Using public transportation, as I said, automobiles, bus, train, ship, plane, being in open spaces like parking lots, marketplace, bridge. These are just examples. Any open space will do, okay? Being in enclosed places like shops, theaters, cinemas, standing in line or being in a crowd or being outside of the home alone. These are the five situations. In any two or more of the following situations, there is marked fear or anxiety. The individual fears or avoids the situation because of thoughts that escape might be difficult or help might not be available in the event of developing panic-like symptoms or other incapacitating or embarrassing symptoms like fear of falling in the elderly, fear of incontinence. How will I escape? What will happen? I will be embarrassed. The agoraphobic situations almost always provoke fear and anxiety. It is not that in 6 months only once I will develop it, okay? Suppose I have fear of traveling in train. Every day, if I travel, every day I will have that fear. fear. It's not that 10 times I travel, one time only will I have fear. Every time, almost always, it provokes anxiety. The agoraphobic situations are actively avoided. I will avoid going in train. I will not go. I will leave the job. I will change my job. Like that. They are almost actively avoided, or they require the presence of a companion, or are endured with intense fear or anxiety. I will ask one of my family members to come with me. If they don't come with me, if I can't change a job, I will go in train. But I will be extremely fearful. I will be sitting coward in a corner of the compartment. Okay? I will be very fearful. The fear or anxiety is out of proportion to the actual danger posed by the agoraphobic situations and the socio-cultural context, right? Yeah. What will happen if I go in a train? Nothing will happen. Nothing will happen. Nothing happens. But the fear is very much more than the situation demands. And other people are not fearful, okay? It's not like everybody is fearful. Only I am fearful, and it is very much more than what the situation demands. It's not like, you know, being afraid of a tiger or lion, that is not phobia, okay? That is reality. You have to be afraid, otherwise they will attack you, they might kill you. But going in a train or seeing a cockroach, these are not fearful in general. But you are having anxiety, so those are disorders. The fear, anxiety or avoidance is persistent, typically lasting for 6 months or more. So they are long-lasting illnesses. At least they should be present for 6 months, then only we can diagnose this as a phobia or a disorder. So the next question is, a 30-year-old male came in psychiatry OPD with complaint of irrational fear in market and theater, which is the most probable diagnosis. So the underlining thing is here, irrational fear in market and theater. So claustrophobia, social phobia, acrophobia and agoraphobia. And the answer is agoraphobia. Now, claustrophobia is fear of enclosed spaces. We'll go into that detail in next class. Claustrophobia, enclosed space means it may be a lift. Most common is a lift, you know. Lift, many people will be there and it will be small space. Or it may be other crowded places. Okay. Social phobia is scared that I'll go in public and people will laugh at me because of some perceived deformity. Perceived means actually there is no deformity, but the patient will feel, yeah, there is some deformity. Like I may think that, okay, my nose is very short, so people will laugh at me. It may or may not be short, but who cares if my nose is short? Like nobody cares my nose is short. Nobody is looking at my nose and laughing. Everybody is busy in their own work, right? So, but the patient with social phobia will think, no, my nose is short, so obviously everybody will laugh at me. Or they are afraid to speak. Like they will think, if I speak and I falter, I stutter, people will laugh at me. But actually, that is not so. Because of their less confidence or, you know, because of this disorder, they are afraid. So that is social phobia, okay? Acrophobia will go in detail. That is a specific phobia. We'll go in detail in next class. And agoraphobia is this, like being in, you know, in open spaces or being outside home and irrational fear of that. So this is the criteria again. I'll skip it since we just discussed it. So now we come to the treatment part. Agoraphobia is treated with A. Systemic desensitization, B. Relaxation theory, C. Behavior theory, and D. All the above. So the answer is all the above. Now what is systemic desensitization? Systemic desensitization is itself a behavioral technique. Okay. Whereby a person is gradually exposed to an anxiety-producing object, event or place while being engaged in some type of relaxation at the same time in order to reduce the symptoms of anxiety. So systemic desensitization has two parts. First, the patient has to master the art of being relaxed. How do we do that? There are different techniques. One is progressive muscle relaxation. Like there will be tape playing or somebody will be speaking and they will ask you to progressively relax your different muscles, group of muscles. It will start with first relax your forearm, right one, left one, upper arm, your chest, abdomen, thighs, calf muscles. Like that it progresses. Then when you are completely relaxed, they will start this systemic desensitization. Systemic desensitization means the patient will list the situations in an order. First will be least fearful. Suppose I am afraid of being on a train. Let's say take the same example. I am afraid of being on a train. So which is least fearful? Least fearful is looking at a picture of a train. Okay? that is least fearful. Or maybe imagining a train is least fearful. Then next is looking at a picture of a train. Then third is looking at a real train. Okay. Fourth is sitting in a train. Not running, just sitting in a train. Fifth is sitting in a moving train. You understood? There is a hierarchy. Okay. Least fearful, most fearful. I will make the hierarchy, not the doctor. The patient will make it. Okay. The patient will prepare the hierarchy of his fears. सबसे कम डर लगता है, सबसे ज्यादा डर लगता है. Least fearful, most fearful. Already here she has practiced and mastered the art of relaxation. Okay. So the doctor will start. Okay. Doctor or therapist will start. Okay. Imagine the least fearful situation. Okay. I will imagine a train. Then I will start having anxiety. Oh, I'm imagining a train. Imagine. Then I will say, doctor will say, now you relax. So I will relax myself by the exercise that I have learned. So this continues for many sessions till even at home or even subconsciously, even at market, anywhere. I can imagine a train and I am not fearful anymore because I have taught my brain that imagining a train is not stressful. Okay? Then we'll go to the next in the hierarchy. That is what? Seeing a picture of a train. So I'll go to the therapy session. The therapist will show me a picture of a train. I'll be like, oh, 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 train, train, train. Oh, I'm getting anxiety. Then the therapist will be like, okay, we'll start relaxation. Then he will relax me, make me relax, you know, do the exercise. Then I will do the exercise there also, at home also, practice it. Thinking about the, seeing the picture of the train. This continues for many sessions. Then, whenever I look at a picture of train, I am no more afraid because I have taught my brain that there is nothing threatening at looking at the picture of a train. So, you understood the process? This goes on and on till at last, after many months, it is a gradual process, okay? Doesn't happen overnight. After many months, I can sit in a train, a traveling, moving train, and I have taught myself relaxation, okay? So, when the anxiety starts, I will relax myself. Or the doctor may be there or may not be there, okay? I will relax myself, and then I will teach myself that nothing is happening. I will teach on myself relaxation till a few sessions in the train, and then finally I'll be able to sit in a train without consciously relaxing myself because I've taught my brain that sitting in a train is not threatening. So even if I sit in a train, I'll be automatically relaxed. This is a long process, gradual process. Patience and dedication is required for this to work. Okay. I hope I am clear. That is systematic desensitization. Relaxation therapy refers to a number of techniques that are designed to teach someone to be able to relax voluntarily. These techniques can include special breathing practices and progressive muscle relaxation exercises, which are designed to reduce physical and mental tension. Progressive muscle relaxation, PMR. If you want, you can also search on YouTube, PMR, progressive muscle relaxation. You will get many videos in which there will be a therapist speaking and you can just put on earphones. Lie down, quiet place, and practice it yourself if you want. So, we'll come to the next question, which is, a 20 years old female complains of sudden onset palpitation and apprehension. She is sweating for last 10 minutes and fears of impending death. Diagnosis is, see, sudden onset, palpitation, sweating, 10 minutes, impending death. So the answer must be very clear by now. A. Hysteria. B. Generalized anxiety disorder. C. Cystic fibrosis. Or D. Panic attack. And the correct answer is D. Panic attack. I hope by now it is very clear why this is panic attack. So there is a slide. Symptoms of panic disorder. Choking, chest pains, distress, difficulty breathing, rapid, shallow breathing, all related to the chest. Tingling in fingers or toes like pins and needles, hot flashes, sudden chills, nausea, dizziness, lightheadedness, trembling, shaking, sweating, fearful that you are going to go crazy or about to die, terror that is almost paralyzing. It is very, very distressing for the patient. You cannot understand how distressing it is until you yourself have a panic attack. Like it is very, very much distressing. Nervousness, feelings of dread, fear, apprehension, anxiety, raging heartbeat, increased heartbeat, heart palpitations. Okay. Now the next question is, a 30-year-old lady She complains of sudden onset breathlessness, anxiety, palpitation, feeling of impending doom. Physical examination is normal. This is a very vital clue. Physical examination is normal. So it rules out all medical disorders. Diagnosis is panic attack, anxiety, acute psychosis and conversion disorder. I think the answer is very clear by now. So it will be panic attack. Again, the same thing is there. If you want to remember the symptoms of panic attack, a very easy method is like in this picture. You just remember head, okay? Start from head. There will be fearful, terror, impending doom, nervousness, anxiety. Then come to the throat. There will be constriction of throat, choking sensation. Then come to the chest, okay? There will be palpitations, rapid heartbeat, then difficulty, you know, breathing. Then come to the toes, I mean extremities. It will be pins and needles, cold extremities, also nausea, dizziness. So in this way you can remember. Start from the head and then go downwards. Okay. Next question is, there is complaint of decreased sleep, excessive worry in a young female since 1 year, even when she is relaxed. What is probable diagnosis? Panic disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, schizophrenia or conversion disorder? See, the question here is decreased sleep and excessive worry since 1 year, even when she is relaxed. Why is it important even when she is relaxed? This excludes panic disorder, you know. A panic attack, when the person is having panic attack, he is not relaxed. You cannot be relaxed and have panic attack at the same time. That is why for the treatment of panic disorder, we teach relaxation. Because you, conflicting emotions, conflicting mechanisms cannot be present at the body at the same time. Either you can be anxious or you can be relaxed, okay? You cannot be both simultaneously. So, if she is relaxed, she is not having panic disorder. So, that is ruled out. Then excessive worry, okay? So, the most probable diagnosis is generalized anxiety disorder. Right, generalized anxiety disorder. So, what are the symptoms of the generalized anxiety disorder? Increased muscle aches or soreness. Many patients come with us, you know, mere haath pair mein dard ho raha hai, mere kamar mein, peeth mein dard ho raha hai. They first go to the orthopedics or the medicine doctor. After repeated treatment and investigation, nothing is happening. Then they come to us, okay? Impaired concentration. Patient says, I keep forgetting where I have kept my keys, where I have kept my, you know, other bag. Or when I am cooking, I keep forgetting whether I have added salt or not. And if I am studying, I cannot remember, like the same page I will be studying 10 times, but I will not be able to remember. Irritability. They will be very irritated, always irritated. Like if you tell them a small thing, minor thing also, they will, you know, react intensely. They will be, okay, mujhse baat mat karo, don't keep talking to me, shut up or something like that. And the patient's relatives and friends say, I don't know why anything we say, even if you say something good also, he or she is getting irritated. Difficulty sleeping. In depression also there is difficulty sleeping, but depression the mood will be sad. Here the mood is worrisome or irritated. Excessive anxiety and worry which is difficult to control. And that is about everyday affairs, okay? Like the normal thing. It's not that exactly something big is happening, like some exam is happening or some marriage is happening, nothing like that. Everyday nothing is happening. Life is okay. But still there is excessive anxiety and worry which the patient finds difficult to control. There is fatigue. Patient will say, I am very tired. Even if I don't do anything, I am very tired and I am restless. So those are the symptoms of generalized anxiety disorder. Now, the next question is, panic attack is associated with disturbance in all of the following neurotransmitters except serotonin, glutamate, adenosine. None. So the answer is none. Like we had already discussed it, serotonin, norepinephrine, glutamate, GABA, adenosine, these are all involved. Okay. Norepinephrine in the locus coeruleus, serotonin in the midbrain, GABA in the limbic system, and adenosine or cholecystokinin at CNS sites, which are not yet identified. So, the last question for today is, regarding panic attack, true is, may present with carpopedal spasm, hyperventilation can cause T wave changes in ECG, SpO2 will be normal to make this diagnosis. There is no associated suicide risk with recurrent episode. So, which is true? Okay? And the answer is SPO2 will be normal. What is carpopedal spasm? That happens mostly in calcium deficiency. Their hand and the leg, carpo is hand. Hand, basically palms and the foot sole will go into spasm like this. Okay. So that is carpopedal spasm, mostly seen in calcium deficiency. TUF changes are not seen in ECG. If TUF changes are seen, that may be most probably a cardiac cause, not a panic attack. SpO2 will be normal. Like I had said, SpO2 is partial saturation of oxygen in blood. There is a small instrument. You have to put it on the finger and then it will give the reading. Mostly it will be 99, 98, 100, like that. So the patient will complain of difficulty in breathing, choking sensation, constriction of throat, constriction of chest. I cannot breathe. But actually the patient is able to breathe, okay? So the SpO2 will be normal. So we know that it is a panic attack and not some respiratory or cardiac cause. There is no associated suicide risk with recurrent episode. This is false, okay? There is suicide risk. Remember, you may say panic attack is a very minor thing. Why is the patient having suicidal ideas? Because panic attack is very distressing, very, very distressing. And when they happen repeatedly over months and years, because you see, not everybody comes to the doctor immediately. Some come after months or years. So at that time, they will be so distressed that they will be like, it is better to die than live like this. So there is suicidal risk in panic disorder. So the correct answer is panic attack, SpO2 will be normal. And that concludes. Thank you.